Place Dry Cleaners, Van Aken Center, Cleveland, Ohio, winter 1978. A silver Ford LTD sits outside. A demi-jaded 14-year-old, using a book bag as big as she is for an ottoman, stares out the passenger seat window. Her mother is giving the counter person inside a very hard time. Kid Leo, the afternoon god of Rolling Stone's radio station of the year, is talking in that deep-throated street guy way to anyone in Cleveland, Ohio in the 70s listening to WMMS's Duriker. And once again, from Akron, Ohio, he says, ramping the hype, by way of London, England, it's a local girl. He pauses dramatically. Last time Leo Trevigliante talked like that, it was Chrissy Hynde's import single, Stop Your Sobbing. The kid leans forward. All the way from Firestone High School, it's Miss Rachel Sweet, rocking out on Carla Thomas's B-A-B-Y, baby. Creamy, lush, horn punctuations. It's a 60s soul thing going on, but the kid in the car is knocked out when a massive voice rolls out of the speakers, brazen and knowing. This kid is from Firestone? The mother, cigarette extended perpendicular from her pink parrot clawed fingers, opens the door. I've told you not to run the battery down playing the GD radio. Then the wash of Primotown soul hits her. Mrs. Gleason stuck her helmet-haired head in the car. What are you listening to? This doesn't sound like the shit on WMMS. Baby! Ooh, baby! I love to call you, baby! Cut to Akron, Ohio. Early spring. 1977. Rachel Sweet is 14, already owning local television, winning third place in a garage door opener on the Gene Carroll show at 5. She's toured with Mickey Rooney, then done a casino residency in Reno and Las Vegas with Bill Cosby at 11. By 8, she'd landed her first national TV spot, 10 national television commercials later, including ads for Snack Pack Pudding, Dole Bananas, Colgate Toothpaste, GE Washers and Dryers, and Faygo Red Pop. She retires at the tender age of 11 from jingle singing and commercial work altogether. Next stop, Nashville, long before Taylor Swift, but hot on the heels of Tanya Tucker, recording in the very same studio as Tammy Wynette. Signed to teeny Texas indie label Derek Records, their next Tanya Tucker vision never materializes. Only one single, We Live in Different Worlds, manages to crack the top 100 country songs. Besides, Rachel Sweet didn't want to do show tunes with a Vegas band, commercials for Pudding Pops, or hillbilly music. Like every red-blooded American teenager of the day, she wanted to rock. As she confessed to Penny Valentine in a 1979 Cream magazine profile, I don't object to that kind of Broadway show singer stuff, but you can't do that and get 15,000 kids excited, which is what I want to do. One day, the kid with the really big voice, the drip paint, and raw brass does her dad a favor. His best friend's son, a music major who'd been banging around Europe after college, needed someone to sing some demos. Not quite 30, Liam Steinberg convinced Stiff Records Dave Robinson, who just lost out on signing Devo to a full record deal and was releasing a string of European singles for the Dadaist concept rockers, that there were more like that where Mark Mother's buying company came from. With a deal to produce the Akron compilation, Sternberg and accomplice Chris Butler needed artists fast. Rachel Sweet thought the songs were kind of odd, but always a professional, she leaned into the lyrics. Truck Stop Queen, about a waitress who owned the whole string of truck stops, sounded like the kind of country she'd left behind. Tourist Boys, with its strange tropical rhythms, took the same predatorial carnality that could be seen in places like, say, Fort Lauderdale. She finishes the session, something she's done plenty of, and goes home. Doesn't think anything about it. Cut to Stiff Records office, London, England, 1977. Dave Robinson found the whole Akron thing amusing. Stiff, the ironic, iconic little label with smutty double entendre marketing, had already given the world Elvis Costello, Nick Lowe, The Damned, and Ian Drury. Partner Jake Rivera was leaving to form Radar Records with Costello and Lowe, so magic was needed fast. Perhaps this Akron compilation would hold some magic. Certainly the large lunged female, whose voice was both new wave and Brenda Lee retro, seemed promising. A call to inquire about her availability delivered shocking news. Rachel Sweet was 14 years old when she did the vocals. Cut two, Akron, later that spring, 1977. Rachel's mother lies in a bed in the family's living room, looking out on her backyard. With the Akron compilation, with its scratch and sniff smell of burning rubber cover being released only in England, there were no American rave reviews for her to see. As Sweet would tell the Associated Press's Mary Campbell, Liam was intent on selling his Akron compilation. He sold the idea to Stiff. He sold them the demos. Next thing I knew, I was getting reviews for an album I didn't know I was on. 2 weeks after her mother died, Rachel and her 17-year-old sister boarded a plane to the UK. The promise of a month in London for the two girls to see how working with Stiff felt had been offered by Robinson. Rachel Sweet's real-time Jailbait rock and punk rebellion was about to begin.
They were both in England alone, you know, and both on the continent, and I have no reluctance to send them anywhere.
Dining room, Nashville, Tennessee. Kitchen, La Pinata, California, July 2020. When I went to London, I basically moved over there and stayed for 2 years, Rachel Sweet is telling me. I was living with one of the Stiff promo guys in a flat in London. He was supposed to look after me, whatever that meant. But I was in London in the middle of all of it. I couldn't get into too much trouble because my dad was my manager and everybody knew, but I had a really good time. Cut to Eden Recording Studios, Chiswick, London, August 1978. Lyme Sternberg was hired as the producer of Rachel Sweet's first album. Retreating to a rambling country house rented from Simon Climie's mother, drummer Mark Sugden shared with Facebook's Rachel Sweet Spot in March of 2019, the pair spent 10 days in pre-production imagining, quote, a girl country singer meets Captain Beefheart, unquote. Robinson wasn't so sure, so the sessions at Eden, they morphed. Basic tracks were done by the pair, drums and guitars. Sternberg then overdubbed bass, piano, or more guitars. As the drummer recalls, Rachel's vocal sessions were extraordinary. She was always upbeat, laughing, and positive. She'd have the main vocal down in the first or second take. We were sure we were listening to a future superstar. Brinsley Schwartz, Lena Lovitch, members of the Blockheads, Gilded Sweet's debut. And no, Rachel Sweet was not passively sitting by. When the label felt they needed a single or singles, Carla Thomas's Baby was suggested by Robinson, cherry-picked to launch the 16-year-old's career. As the song gets traction at radio, Top of the Pops beckons. It appears Stiff might just have that hit they needed as they release albums on this next wave of artists. Her shot in the balance, she had opinions she was not afraid to voice. Before leaving for the station, a follow-up single of I Fall to Pieces was produced by David McKay. Sweet herself was the force behind the producer change. As she told Penny Valentine for Cream, Liam's basically an improviser. I mean, who does Lisa like as an 8-7 time? That's pretty difficult. And I needed somebody more versed in technology at the studio, who knew harmonies, rhythms, arrangements. Lime's a bit ours, and if he comes out sounding good, man, then it was okay by him. He's not there and I go to pieces and I want to cry. Go to pieces and I almost die every time my baby passes by. Go to pieces and I almost die. Cut to Facebook, 2019. Stiff's Dave Robinson told the Rachel Sweet Spot fan page on Facebook to celebrate 40 years of the anniversary of Fooled Around, the impact that the album had on the B-Stiff train tour. He said the single Baby was the door opener and then the tour. Rachel was always on the case and the journalists were amazed by her. Rachel's album also helped Stiff move from a moribund U.S. deal at Arista to CBS Records. As Robinson recalls, Columbia wanted Rachel, and Rachel's dad wanted to be in the U.S. the record company who launched the teen with buttons proclaiming, "I fooled around with Rachel Sweet," and the slogan, "We have racial prejudice," was off and running. Cut two. A train moving away from or towards a platform somewhere in the UK, October, November 1978. The Be Stiff Route 78 tour was meant to reprise a stunt the label with the marketing slogan, "If it ain't stiff, it ain't worth a..." had originally staged in 1977 with Elvis Costello and Ian Drury. Five acts, the Frisky New Wave Roadshow with Nick Lowe, Reckless Eric, and Leary Wallace, watched My Aim Is True become a smash, and Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll become an anthem. So hopes were high when they left the station. We had Phonogram, Braun, Ensign, and the New Musical Express on board as sponsors, helping to underwrite what NME reported at a cost of somewhere around £100,000. If Sweet, tagged Akron's dream date, was required to take a tutor, and NME, Melody Maker, Sounds and Cream, all ran pictures of her with her school books, she refused to slide into the teen queen novelty bin. Been there, done that, she knew better. Sternberg, also on the train, told MNE, "She's a potential star. I don't interfere with her life. There are too many people concerned with her well-being. She's a tough nut." Still, as she would tell Robert Palmer in a 1981 New York Times piece titled, "Are Teenage Singers Exploited?" "I was traveling on a train with my sister, Lena Lovitch, and about 40 guys, and you should have seen some of the girls these guys would bring on the train. The musicians didn't even know the girls' names. Actually, I don't think the girls knew the guys' names either. You play guitar? All right." It was like that. Horrible. That wasn't all. Given this was her shot, the 5-foot-nothing power singer was going for it. Looking back now, she confesses, "I had a tutor and they had to fire the tutor because she was sleeping with my bass player. It was fun. There were times I was not aware what was going on, but when I got on that stage, I went for it. It's 11 o'clock at night. I'm 16 years old. How great is this? I was living the life." And the life was awesome. If nobody broke wide like Elvis Costello, no less than Elton John showed up at a gig. She remembers, "I just wanted to be in the thick of it. It was a heady time. The first album I ever bought was Elton John's Greatest Hits. So we're on this train tour, and Elton comes backstage. It was so very immediate. The tour, everything. You'd be doing backup vocals for the others. Then you're in London, going out to see whoever's playing. There were so many bands that you wanted to see." Cut to 241 Moreno Drive, Beverly Hills, California, winter 1978. Marie McKee, 14, is strung out on We Will Rock You, Rodney on the Rock, Disco, Todd Rundgren's Can We Still Be Friends. A girl not much older than she headlines the Sunset Strip's iconic Whiskey A Go-Go, and the next day at Beverly Hills High, the buzz on Rachel's Sweet is so loud, Maria McKee buys Fool Around. Her response is so visceral and immediate, she tells Mojo in their Record Save My Life Last Night feature, "She seemed so profound, she blew me out of my Saturday night fever fog. It's classic girl groups, but modern and fresh, and I'd never heard somebody do so many styles before." More importantly, Rachel Sweet was living the life. A world away, but a world experiencing its own Madame Wong's fueled zeitgeist, the future roots rock siren wrote, "She was 16 and hanging out with all the cool London people, being on Stiff with Ian Drury and the Blockheads, touring with them. She must have known Elvis Costello. She sang Stranger in the House on Fool Around, and it's country, it's punk, and it's soul. She's got that baby voice, but there is real muscle in there too." There's a stranger in the house, nobody's seen her face. Everybody says she looks like me. Cut to Record Revolution, Coventry Road, Cleveland Heights, Ohio, early 1979. A giant day-glow Elvis Costello overwhelms a massive picture window. Record Revolution epicenters the new wave and punk coming out of the UK and New York in AOR, Mecca, Cleveland. For a high school kid in a plaid skirt, it's not a friendly environment, but it is the only place where you can get NME or Melody Maker. whipped in pasty-faced clerks, sometimes with razor blades hanging from their earlobes, lobbed to stain like gob spit. "Kid," barked the sunken-eyed guy behind the counter. "Kid." Surely he wasn't talking to me. The store was empty. I was scared. I didn't want to buy any drugs, and I really didn't want to get insulted. Clearing his throat and sucking snot into his head, he says, "You're going to like this," reaching under the counter. He pulled out a record with a dark-haired girl, a girl about my age. "Fool around," Rachel Sweet had said. "She covers Stranger in the House and does a really good job." "Really?" "An import. It's going to be more expensive, but I think you'll like it." I had $20 in my knee sock, Christmas money from my Nana. He held it out, let me look as he kept talking. "She does some oldies stuff your parents will know, and she sings about Firestone High School in Akron." "She does? Really?" We were having a conversation. "She's from there, probably your age." Boom, the insult drops. The record was, I believe, $12.99, but I was curious. I mean, she was almost my age.
I've been through it all. I mean, like, kid-wise, you know, I went to school. I mean, I've done all that. I don't feel like I've grown up too fast. You know, it's just sort of a different phase. I've done that, so I'm into something else.
Cut to Firestone High School, Akron, Ohio, 1979. Rolling Stone's Fred Schreurs is flown to Rubber City. The August 23rd, 1979 piece, "She's 16 and Nobody's Fool." He quotes, "The British press cried jailbait, but were obviously won over, lavishing praise on Fool Around when it was released in October and sold well enough to make her a cover girl in the British rock press." Recognizing the gap between teenager and rock star, he writes of their conversation, "It's not corrupting me as we walk through the high school she is temporarily leaving behind. I can't smoke because of my voice, and I can't drink because I can't control myself. I do like champagne, though." Cut to dining room, Nashville, Tennessee, kitchen, La Pinata, California, July 2020. So the line, talking about boys, who's taken what, and bands we can see tonight, is that drugs or classes, I ask, trying to clarify the debate that raged 30 miles north in Cleveland. "Firestone was really about drinking," laughs Sweet on the other end of the phone. "You just drank and drank and drank and drank. I wrote a song called Billy and the Gun about a kid who had got just so shit-faced. His dad had a gun in the house and he'd just fool with it." So Liam knew my life, more or less. He knew where I grew up and how, and he put it all in the songs. Or like "Pin a Medal on Mary, She's Acting So Scary." That's about the girl who steals your boy and his virginity. All Music Guide says, a Fool Around, "If Stiff Records wanted to market Rachel Sweet as an ironic sex symbol, they succeeded only at the irony of forbidden fruit. The picture of her on the back cover of this disc in a rugby shirt and jeans, head cocked, hands on hips, could grace the cover of Lolita's next edition. Baby sold 130,000 copies in the UK. She now says, vocally it suited me. They wanted to highlight my voice because Lime songs were more about the message and the way they were written, and obviously, Baby worked. It also hit the unspeakable jailbait bullseye with its "You make all the wrong things right" plea. Laughing some more, Sweet confesses, "I was aware of it, I'm not an idiot, and I don't feel bad about it at all. The music is what worked, the rest was marketing. I was certainly playing the image, but it wasn't that far from where I was, you know?" Melody Maker wrote at the time, "Although Stiff have been accused of manipulating Sweet to a degree as a Lolita figure, a piece of jailbait, personally, I'd always thought that Fool Around cover was just a piece of irony, though there could have been some innuendo about putting that track out as a single. It's hard to believe they could push her too far, though, against her will." Because of the gap between Fool Around's release in the UK versus the US, Sweet lived a double life. New Music Express recognized it in their early 1979 profile, What Rachel Did Next, noting that she, quote, "quite naturally led a highly schizophrenic existence without ever stopping to think about it. At school one minute, on stage the next." There's a gulch, though, between being Miss May with Graham Parker as Mr. May in Sounds, 1979 calendar issue, which closed out 1978, as well as being the face of one of the first five picture discs in the UK and touring America as a hopeful with first The Records, then Fingerprints as her backing band. She split her time between opening for The Cars, Parker, and Southside Johnny, with headlining rock rooms like Boston's Paradise with John Hyatt as her opening act, and Toronto's legendary Elma Combo, where the Toronto Sun deemed her rock's young Judy Garland. Cut to New York City, The Bottom Line, multiple nights, late July 1979. The week she turned 17, Robert Palmer writes in his July 25th New York Times review of Southside Johnny in Central Park, "The real interest centered on the opening act, Rachel Sweet. Built around the contrast between her youth and song selection, which sometimes stresses youth and her tough practice demeanor. Like all good Northern Ohio kids, Rachel Sweet worshipped Bruce Springsteen. Signed to Stiff / Columbia, what could be a better birthday gift than, well, her label mate? The bottom line was pretty much where he'd exploded," Sweet explains now. "So when he walked in there, the waters just parted. It was nerve-wracking and intimidating. I didn't freeze up, but, you know, I got through it. Toward the end, someone playing I Don't Want to Go Home, thinking he'd get up, that Southside Johnny song, maybe he would, but he didn't. He did come upstairs. I was a 17-year-old girl and out of my element, intimidated and thrilled all at once. Even now, she admits she can't truly grok what happened. When I look back, it all, it's just sort of frozen in a blur. He was really nice and said stuff about the things I wrote. I was just stunned and happy and thrilled. You meet someone whose lyrics just mean a lot to you. Today, Rachel Sweet still melts back into an awestruck teen." Cut to CBS Records, Black Rock Building, Fifth Avenue, summer of 79. Columbia's ad spoke truth. They'd done the Stiff deal to get Rachel Sweet. Here's why. Someone, no one predicted, Rachel Sweet. The ad also included Stiff's new tagline, "Our record is extremely good." Cut to London. Time to record a follow-up, now 1979. Steeped in Britain's punk culture, Sweet self-manifestation saw tougher edges, stronger self-determination. Enlisting Martin Rushent and Alan Winstanley, who'd just come off of The Stranglers and Gen X, but before either had found their real success, Sweet's Protect the Innocent ran a triple play of The Damned's New Rose, Elvis Presley's Baby Let's Play House, and Lou Reed's New Age, showing the terseness defining her washed in rock punk truth. Still playing with the juxtaposition between teen reality and the voice beyond her years, she'd told Melody Maker when they tracked along on a day of radio visits across Scotland for Fool Around, "I may not have firsthand experience of those lyrics, but I know what's going on and I can pretty much put as much feeling into it as anyone. And this whole male-female thing in music, a woman with straight appeal, that's ambiguous territory and somewhere she intended to go." A fast study with themes, the action was very real. Acknowledging the line, "When you kissed Robert Mitchum on stage," she showed a hunger for drama and a recognition of poetry. Sweet put her own writing out there too. Three songs steeped in raw desire on Protect, including the jazzy coquettish "Hymen Surrendering," "Tonight Ricky." All Music Guide offers in its review the slinky sneaking your boyfriend into the house number. If Britney Spears had dared to sound half as sexy singing about high school seduction, the FCC would have never let her on the air. If Sounds called Fool Around the best record Stiff has ever released, ever, ever, the men don't know, but the little girls understand. The world needed to brace. Protect the Innocence cover featured a scowling black leather clad Sweet with her eyes almost covering a small child's eyes. It was voted worst album cover in the UK that year. "I was straddling the music," she explains in 2020, "and who you are, where you come from, and where you are in the moment. My notion of sexy was rooted in Northeast Ohio, where a button-down shirt open too far was ooh. Then London was leather and everything ripped. You can't get above your raising, and Stiff made it about a 16-year-old American girl from the Midwest in the middle of the new wave, so it was frustrating." Cut to Cleveland, Protect the Innocent Tour, 1979. New York rocker arrives in Cleveland for an Agora Club show. Checking into Swingo's, the Immortal Rock Hotel, they ultimately call their piece a small, mobile, belligerent unit, citing her dissing Van Halen's security guards. Though focused on her inability to perform in a homecoming concert at Firestone because the label thinks it will not sell enough records, her performance of New Age draws real praise. From a nearly whispered, "Can I have your autograph?" Rachel builds to a Joplin-esque frenzy. Therein lies the rub. Rachel Sweet was never able to truly own her agency. In on the joke, she now realizes the marketing, quote, wasn't for the girls. The empowerment part of it, as much as I'd love to say it was about the girls, it was 90% about the boys. Girls who understand got me, but the audiences I usually played to were male. It wasn't weird. I never felt like I was being leered at. It always felt like the music was what it was about. Cut to New York City, early 80s. When Columbia Records took over her contract, they wanted hits. A self-penned concept album produced by Pete Solly was revamped by Rick Chertoff. More vintage covers were inserted, including a gag-inducing duet with teen idol Rex Smith, who wanted rock cred. Everlasting Love, sadly, was Sweet's only American hit. So Rachel Sweet did the most rock, punk, rebellion thing she possibly could. She fulfilled her contract, finished up a double English-French major at Columbia University, and walked away. Maybe I made the wrong decision, she says in retrospect. Columbia's attitude was, I needed a big top 40 record, and it happened. But the change in tone, we couldn't get away from what it was once it happened. I wasn't representing my generation anymore. It became about the voice and the production. It was glossy and not, to quote Penny Lane in Almost Famous, not a what.